If you go ahead and turn your Bibles to Matthew 22, I'll let you know what verses soon, and you'll see those. But that's actually where we're going to be landing first, and before we head back to Romans 13. Last week, be in subjection to the governing authorities, and we outlined several specific things, imperatives. They were commands of reasons why we are to be in subjection from chapter 13. And we want to continue that and sort of pick it up where we left off, but also blend in some things about not only chapter 13, but the Reformation as well and its influence. So I want to pause for prayer, give the Lord thanks, and then we'll begin. Heavenly Father, now for the next few moments, we pray that your Spirit would remove all hindrances out of our hearts and out of our minds to hear what you have to say from your word. And I pray, Heavenly Father, as at the end of it, it will feel like that you fed us from above and you nourished our hearts, and we are much better for it. And we've enjoyed the meal and enjoyed the fellowship around the table of the word. In your name we pray. Amen. At the end of the 15th century, in Europe, there was a letter in God's Word that was the most dangerous letter and carried with it the greatest threat to religion. And it was Paul's letter to the Romans. It was the book of Romans. Galatians also a little bit, but nothing like Romans. And the reason why is because Romans, unlike, quite honestly, anywhere else in the New Testament, Romans is the letter that explains the meaning of Christ's work in his life and his death and his burial and his resurrection. And the only way that a sinner can be justified is by faith alone in Christ alone. That was the greatest dangerous thing to say as a believer, as a follower of Jesus Christ in those days. It was a letter of Romans, that the ordinary people of England should never, ever, ever, ever get a hold of and read on their own, said the Roman Catholic Church. How dare that any peasant, any English-speaking peasant for sure, get a hold of this book and read it on your own? That was one of the greatest threats that the Roman Catholic Church faced in those days. But when it was read in private, whether it was in Jerome's Latin Vulgate or William Tyndale's English translation or a Greek translation, the Reformation was born. It was born in the heart. We need to understand that things that what God does to the heart, it starts there. It doesn't necessarily start ecclesiastical. And like with Martin Luther, it started in the heart. It started in the heart. Reformation begins in the heart. God begins to transform the mind. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. And among many things that did take place, good things that did take place and were gone, the Reformation was born, and then all of a sudden, purgatory was gone. Just like that, purgatory, gone. The practice of penance, gone. Indulgences, gone. Baptismal regeneration, gone. Papal infallibility equal with Scripture, gone. Eucharistic transubstantiation, gone. The mediatorial role of Mary, gone. And on and on and on. Things just started falling apart. And so, yes, the book of Romans had to be avoided at all costs. And it did come with a cost. So in those days began the burning at the stake for anyone caught especially with an English translation, with one of William Tyndale's translations of the New Testament. Well, a few decades go by, and the Reformation is just moving like a fire, just like in a forest, just moving. The Holy Spirit is blowing it. The churches are changing. And by the time you get to the early 1540s, then another man came on the scene, John Calvin. You could read a lot by John Calvin, but if you wanted to read the Cliff Notes, just the Cliff Notes, is there a book out there that I could just, it would just tell me the entire life of the man and I wouldn't have to read that 3-inch book of Institutes and all the hundreds of books that have been written on Calvin. Is there any book out there that I could almost finish in 2 afternoons? Yeah, right there it is. Right there it is. It's called The Legacy of John Calvin, written by David Hall, and it was published 3 years ago on the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. The subtitle, His Influence on the Modern World, and that's what's so unique about this, is that you get an idea of, he was a pastor in Geneva. How much did he really impact the world? What was his influence on the world? This French pastor who died in his late 50s, what was the impact? So I have a few things I'd just like to read from you and to give you an idea of how John Hall writes. It's very smooth, very easy. Here we go. When it pertains to government, because we are looking at Romans 13. Calvin also argued long and hard that government should not and could not do everything. How about that? Well, we could talk for hours just on that line right there and what he said in his Institutes. And it's well documented, this small little book. It had to be limited, that is, government, in its task and scope. If it was not, it would run aground as in the time of the Hebrew prophet Samuel. Calvin's sermon on 1 Samuel 8 addresses one of the most widely expounded passages about political thought in Scripture. His 1561 exposition discusses the dangers of monarchy, the need for proper limitation of government, and the place of divine sovereignty over human governments. It is an example of Calvinism at its best, carefully balancing individual liberty and proper government. For example, John Hall, the Republican-style plan suggested by Jethro, as he speaks to his father-in-law, Moses, remember Exodus 18, appears as an innovation that did not originate in the mind of man, thought Calvin. And so Jethro's advice, according to Calvin, stands as a pristine example of federalism or republicanism. Calvin stating, because remember what happened? The responsibility is too great. Jethro goes to Moses and says, you need to break this all down. And you read that passage out of Deuteronomy chapter 1. What did Moses do? What was the advice? Moses said, you clan, this clan, this clan, this clan, appoint from among yourselves and bring me a representative of your clan who's wise and knows how to lead and make decisions. And I will meet with them and then appoint them as your leaders. In other words, so of the people, by the people. That's where Calvin got that. He got it from Jethro. Not on Jed Clampett and all them, but the other Jethro in Scripture. Calvin stated on that truth, hence it more plainly appears that those who were to preside in judgment were not appointed only by the will of Moses, but elected by the votes of the people. And this is the most desirable kind of liberty, that we should not be compelled to obey every person who may be tyrannically put over our heads, but which allows of election, so that no one should rule except he be approved by us. And this is further confirmed in the next verse, wherein Moses recounts that he awaited the consent of the people and that nothing was attempted which did not please them all. End quote. That's Calvin. One of the procedural safeguards of the 1543 civic reform, a hallmark of the Calvinistic governing ethos, was that the various branches of local government, councils then called, could no longer act unilaterally. Henceforth, at least two councils were required to approve measures before ratification. This early Republican mechanism prevented consolidation of all governmental power into a single council. The driving rationale for this dispersed authority, was a simple but scriptural idea. Even the best of leaders could think blindly and selfishly, so they needed a format for mutual correction and accountability. I'll read one of the final paragraphs. I'm just going to skip. I'm skipping several of them. Let's go straight to this one. at the very end of this section. The Calvinist view of liberty, wherever it spread, as moving out of France and heading north, gave citizens confidence and protections. Within a century, okay, 1660s, within a century, the American colonies would exhibit these Calvinistic distinctives. Why? Because Calvin's Institutes was required reading in every single high school and college in the colonies. Required reading. Most of the time in the original French, because you were required to learn at least three languages by the time you were at the end of high school. Not incidentally, one of the first colonial law codes was named the Massachusetts Body of Liberties. So close were law and liberty that Calvin's disciples customarily associated law codes with tables of liberties. The reason was that a proper understanding of liberty is essential for any successful venture, whether it is business, civic, or religious. Calvin had seen an oppression of liberties both in Paris as Protestants were persecuted and in the eyes of the many Roman Catholic refugees who arrived so regularly at Geneva's walls, and he formed his view of liberties based on God's word and also in a fashion that avoided misuses of it. One more quote. Now I'm really at the end. That was the beginning of the epilogue. And finally, John Calvin was much more than a theologian, and his influence extended far beyond churches. Calvin and his disciples, when measured by this new millennium, will probably be seen to have made more lasting contributions than Napoleon, Albert Einstein, Bill Gates, or Henry Ford. Calvin inspired the cultural changes that gave rise to the political philosophy of the American founders, a truly extraordinary event in world history. Founding fathers such as George Washington, James Madison, Samuel John Adams, Patrick Henry, and Thomas Jefferson stood on the shoulders of some of history's greatest philosophers, not the least of whom was a pastor from Geneva who lived nearly 500 years ago. So if you want to understand the Declaration of Independence, you have to understand John Calvin, because that's what they were looking at. They were looking at Calvin's Institutes. Well, what else did Calvin say? If you turn with me to Matthew chapter 22, verses 15 through 21. And here's the famous passage where they attempt to trap Jesus, to discredit him by raising a question that is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? So let's start at verse 15 and read from verse 15 down through 22. Then the Pharisees went and plotted how to entangle him in his words, and they sent their disciples to him. So this was like a schooling group. The Pharisees training wannabe Pharisees. So they didn't send the Pharisees. They sent these younger boys who are learning how to be malicious. The Pharisees are pros at it. So they're going to send the younger boys. Along with the Herodians, and this was another group of political activists in the first century attempting to defend the Herodian family and their political interests and their political clout. So the Pharisees sent these two kinds of groups, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully, and you do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances." That's some empty flattery there. "Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, because they're getting taught how to be malicious, said, Why put me to the test, you hypocrites?" Man, that's right out of the gate. This is their rookie adventure to try to trap a so-called teacher, and they get called hypocrites. "Show me the coin for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. And Jesus said to them, "Whose likeness and inscription is this?" And they said, Caesar's. Then he said to them, and by the way, this issue had been debated for nearly 100 years because Alexander the Great came in 186 BC and changed the currency, changed so much, and the Jews absolutely hated having to use Caesar's coins. They hated it. And it was always an issue. Then therefore, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's. And when they heard it, they marveled and they left him and went away. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? If Jesus answers yes, then he loses favor with the tax-burdened Jews. They'll kick him out of Jerusalem. They'll kick him out of Israel. If he says no, then he could be accused of insurrection against Rome, against Caesar. So, in my own words, taking a little bit of help from John Calvin, I'll give you four things about this passage. What's going on here? Number one, Jesus is not establishing another kingdom when he supports paying taxes and obeying civil laws. He's not establishing another kingdom. What is he establishing? He's establishing the fact, this is where John Calvin got it, that there is a realm of civil government over you, and there is a divine realm over you. And Jesus does this without giving us any specifics. What does that mean? And Jesus it gives us nothing. Nothing. He doesn't help us. It's like leaves it hanging there. There is a civil government over me, and there is a divine government, a divine realm over me. Moving from that, secondly then, civil government should therefore allow freedom of religion, freedom to worship or not to worship. Freedom to worship and freedom not to worship. That's government's responsibility. And that was the meaning behind Romans chapter 13, verse 3. For rulers are what? They're instituted by God. They're not what? They're not to be a terror to good conduct. Is it good to worship the Lord? Okay. But the government's responsibility is not to terrorize that and make sure it happens. Get to church Sunday morning or we'll put you in jail. In other words, the state should not impose one religion, neither the state prevent religion. And that's where it came, separation of church and state powers. Thirdly, the church should not force. Now, so the second point is civil government. Now to the church. The church should not force the government to enforce to one specific religion. Or one specific religion. Neither should it force the gospel on citizens, of which the Roman Catholic Church did, because there was such an overlap of government and ecclesiastical power under the Roman Catholic Church in the 1500s and previous to that as well. You can still find elements of it today. Let me give you a passage that helps us to understand that the church should never press upon the government to make the citizens come to church. So let's hear from Jesus. Luke chapter 9. Turn with me to Luke 9. Because the disciples, they're still living in those days under the Old Testament covenant, which I'll save most on the next point. They're still living in the old way of thinking. And I'll say something to that in just a moment. Look at Luke 9, verse 42. Luke 9, verse 42. While he was coming, the demon threw him to the ground and convulsed him, but Jesus rebuked an unclean spirit and healed the boy and gave him back to his father. And all were astonished at the majesty of God. But while they were all marveling at everything he was doing, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let these words sink into your ears. The Son of Man is about to be delivered into the hands of men." But they did not understand this saying, and it was concealed from them so that they might not perceive it. And they were afraid to ask him about this saying. An argument arose among them as to which of them was the greatest, but Jesus, knowing the reasoning of their hearts, took a child and put him by his side and said to them, "Whoever receives this child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me. For he who is least among you all is the one who is great." John answered, "Master, we saw someone casting out demons." So it goes back to that issue of verse 42. They saw someone else, not Jesus. "Master, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he does not follow with us." But Jesus said to them, "Do not stop him, for the one who is not against you is for you." And when the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him who went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make preparations for him. But the people did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" There it is. But he turned and rebuked them. They're not obeying. They're not getting in church. Isn't this the right thing to do? Just burn them? And if we burn this city down, when we go to the next city, word will spread. I'll guarantee you we'll have 100% attendance next Sunday. Put money on it. No, it's not the church's responsibility to see to it by mandate, pressing in on the government or any other order to make sure that people are in worship. There was a real separation that John Calvin saw here in this statement. Render to Caesar the things that belong to Caesar and to God the things that belong to God. So now, having said all that, now this fourth statement, which may be the most important. Some things belong to the state while all things, including the state, belong to God. Some things belong to the state while at the same time all things belong to God, including the state. Now we're back at Romans 13. Because why? Because all governmental authorities have been instituted by God. They belong to him. And Jesus said to Pilate, "You would have no authority unless my Father in heaven had given it to you." Men do not inherently own authority. We're not born with that authority. It's bestowed as a temporary gift by God. So even the state belongs to God. And this distinction that Jesus makes here in Matthew 22 has had a monumental influence and effect upon the world. His statement ushered in a new order that did away with the theocracy of Israel. Theocracy, two words put together, theos, Greek for God, ocracy, government, God's government or the government of God. So when Jesus says, "Render to Caesar the things that belong to Caesar, to God the things that belong to God, some things belong to the state, all things belong to God, including the state," and at the same time, here comes a new order. The church is no longer responsible to wield governmental authority like Israel did, being a theocracy, wield governmental authority over its citizens, worship God, or you'll die. That's gone. That is gone. Because not only was Israel expected to worship God alone, but was obliged to have no other gods before you under penalty of law. But now Jesus is saying that the things of God are not to be under the control of government, while at the same time government is to influence for good by punishing evil. And that government should get their understanding of what is good and evil from God's word, what we said Sundays ago. So back to chapter 13. Here we go. Back to 13. Verse 1. I'm just going to read the first three verses. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. Why? Because rulers are not a terror to good conduct. They're not to terrorize the citizens to do what they ought to do. They should do it, but it's not the government's role to do that, but only one, and that is to stand at attention with the sword in its sheath, and when they see evil and bad conduct, draw that sword. That's its role. We said several things last time of reasons why from this entire text of why are we to submit to the government. But now let's raise a question. Why does Paul come across so black and white here in chapter 13, picking it up where we were last week? So black and white with submission to government, without any wiggle room or recourse. How can Paul lay down such a blanket statement of unquestioned submission? Because that's the way it comes across. Just unquestioned submission to governing authorities. And here is one answer. As I see how scripture, how God writes his word, God always begins with the standard first, then moves to the exceptions or the qualifications. So let me give you an example. The Bible teaches wives submit to your husbands by supporting his leadership. It just says it, boom. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21 and forward. Next set of verses, it says, husbands, submit to your wives, by implication of verse 21. They're both submitting, they're just not doing it in the same way. Husbands, you submit to your wives by laying down your life the way Christ did. Chapter 6, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Just blanket statements. No wiggle room, no exceptions, no qualifications. So here's my point. God never starts like this with his imperatives throughout Scripture. He never starts with commands like this. Children, if your parents are worthy of your obedience, then obey. Doesn't start like that. God never talks like that. It's not where he starts. Husbands, if your wife has done superbly this week, lay down your life for her. Wives, if your husband has proved his undying affection and love for you, then support his leadership. The point is, God never starts with exemptions or qualifiers for submission or obedience. And here's why. Because we are minimalists at heart. We are minimalists at heart. And God knows our hearts. Have you ever told a little child, as a parent, don't touch that? And you know what they do?
Children do it all the time.
They'll give you the bare minimum. And that's my heart, and that's your heart. You see, this is why God talks this way. Because if he started with the minimum, with all the exemptions and the qualifiers and the exceptions and everything, you know what we'd do? We would give him our bare minimum. In fact, we'd probably find ways to even get out of that as well. So God's word is not starting with a qualifier or an exception to the rule. But does he have them? Yes, so you start with Romans 13, make sure that's intact, and then move to what is understood as civil disobedience. So now we'll raise the question, are there any circumstances by which Caesar is not to be obeyed? And if you're staying with me after worship today for our brown bag luncheon discussion, this is primarily the emphasis because there is no way in the world that this is a sermon all by itself, just the issue of civil disobedience. So anything that I said today, of course, and anything that we've been talking about here in Romans 13 is open for discussion today. But in particular, I do have something for you with regard to civil disobedience. So let me say it like this. God does not hold people responsible for obeying the civil government when obedience to the civil government would mean directly disobeying a command of God himself. And we'll give you six categories that I see in Scripture of how we may obey God rather than man. For of course, one, the most famous one, Matthew chapter 28, Jesus is speaking to his disciples before he's ascended. And what does he say? Go into all the world, preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, teaching them all things that I've commanded you, and I will be with you to the end of the age. Go to all nations, preach the gospel. After Jesus' ascension, they start preaching the gospel. And there it's recorded in Acts chapter 4 and chapter 5, he's preaching the gospel, and the apostle Peter gets thrown into jail for preaching the gospel, and then he's warned upon release and after being flogged, don't say another word about Jesus. And that's when the apostle Peter responds, we will obey God rather than man. And Scripture seems to commend that. For example, if John and Michelle Stewart said, Ivan, when you're on the clock driving that truck, you are not permitted to witness to these truck drivers. What would I do? I would obey. I would. If John and Michelle Stewart said, but when you're off the clock, out in the parking lot, or before you clock in, or if I hear about you getting these guys together in any way at all, with two or three of them, and meeting with them to have prayer and have a Bible study, you are not permitted to speak the name of Jesus to these men in any way, shape, or matter. You know what I would say? Now I'm ready to obey God rather than man. That's what I mean. And I think that's what Scripture means. Secondly, there's six categories. Secondly, to worship God alone and him alone. Daniel chapter 3 shows that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, when the music sounded and the call was given, that they would not bow the knee to Nebuchadnezzar. And since they did not bow the knee, saying that God is able to save us from this furnace, but if he is not, let it be known to you, O king, we will not bow down to you. We worship God alone and no one else. Not syncretism, which is mostly today, coexist. We're going to worship God. We're going to worship Nebuchadnezzar. We're going to worship them. We're all the same. No, we're not. No, we're not. And there's only one God, and his name is Jesus, not Allah. So God showed his approval of their disobedience by rescuing them in the fire, worshiping God alone. Thirdly, another third category, to save human life, to save human life. Pharaoh commanded the Egyptian midwives to put newborn Hebrew babies, boys, to death. They disobeyed. And they actually fabricated a little bit of the truth. Oh, they're vigorous. When they're on the birthing stool, we just can't get there in time. And they rescued babies and they rescued Moses. To save human life, I will obey God rather than man. Fourth category, to save a people group from ethnic genocide. When it was against the law to approach King Ahasuerus uninvited, Esther obeyed the law and risked her own life to save her people, the Jews, saying to her uncle Mordecai, if I perish, I perish. And God rewarded her courage, and Ham was hung on the gallows that he had built for Jews. A fifth category that we may obey God rather than man is to freely pray in public. Freely pray in public. The edict came down, there will be no public prayers to the God of heavens. So what did Daniel do? He went up into his upper chamber. The window was big because it's a platform. And he got right in the window. He didn't have to do that, but he did. So everyone could see him. And he started praying to God three times a day so that everyone could see him praying and disobeying that edict. Consequently, he was thrown into a den of lions for that disobedience. God approved that disobedience by rescuing Daniel. And finally, see another category. And this one we could talk about a lot. This is interesting. To withhold information that would protect life. When Herod commanded that the wise men return and report the location of Jesus, the newborn King of Kings, the angel appeared to them and warned them to not obey Herod. Go this way. And Herod was furious. And what did he do? He went after killing every single baby boy in the entire region, aged 2 years old and under, for that. But it was the angel of the Lord that told the wise men from the east, don't go back to Herod. And they obeyed God rather than man. Raises lots of issues. There's a lot of things that has happened in church history, including it would take maybe an hour to discuss Dietrich Bonhoeffer's attempt to assassinate Hitler. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a German pastor, was hung in Germany 3 weeks before the Allies arrived. He was exposed. There's been hard things in church history. And I'm not saying that it's an easy category to discuss what it means to obey God rather than man. I do want to say this. I think Church of Jesus Christ in Western society, where it has been relatively free to worship Jesus Christ, get ready. I think you're about to be challenged in years and decades to come of what it means to obey God rather than man. The reason why is because the gospel of Jesus Christ is one of the most polarizing messages that you could take to man, because it has to do with sex between a man and a woman, because the gospel is patterned. I mean, the marriage is actually patterned after the gospel that Jesus has a wife, and therefore I cannot cave in to all the things that are happening with gender identity and sexuality that is being pushed upon the church to accept. There's all kinds of things that I just cannot accept. So these things are important to us. It's not just church history stuff. It's our time. What will this look like for you and for me? What would this look like for our children and grandchildren? Ashley posted a picture yesterday. I pray that God would use it. Cheryl and I are always concerned, as we all are, about the way our children and grandchildren are behaving, and we're concerned about them. And we never stop being parents, right? Frankly, we never stop being parents, do we? We don't. We just don't. And Ashley posted a picture last night. It was time to make sure the boys get reading time alone in their bed. Now they all have their own bedroom. They all have their own bedroom. And so there's less fights, that's sort of good, but they got to grow up sometime and get along with somebody. Ashley walks into Joseph's bedroom, and he's reading the biography of John Calvin. Because Joseph is looking for big words, old big words. Okay, fine. Lord, would you be merciful? And open up Joseph's eyes to see and hear how much John Calvin loved Jesus Christ and loved the gospel and loved the word and was willing to die. And John Calvin's own words in one of his memoirs, 50 to 60 black powder guns aimed at his door to march in, bust the doors down, and just fill him with, as we would say in West Virginia, pumpkin balls. Ball bearings. Because he was what? Preaching the gospel. And it was affecting all of Geneva for good. People quit stealing. They quit killing. They quit robbing. Sex sins were declining. The gospel had an effect. I want to raise one final question. You got an hour extra sleep tonight, so I'm keeping you over. Or at least you should have. I want to raise a question. This is a great way to end this subject. There will be government in the future kingdom of God on earth. What? I thought government was a result of the fall. No, it wasn't. It was there in seed form. Adam, name the animals. Adam, subdue the earth and make it obey you. Adam, till the ground. There was something going on in terms of responsibility of overseeing and maintaining what was under your jurisdiction for the benefit of all. I'm going to just cite one passage, and then I'm going to ask you to turn to one with me. Luke chapter 19, verse 11, through the end of the chapter, Jesus tells a parable what the kingdom of God is like. And each one get the same kind of money. You get a denarius, you get a denarius, you get a denarius. You get $10, you get $10, you get $10. Now go and do my will. And there's a verse there. It's actually, if you were to translate this Greek word, and become an entrepreneur. The King James translated, do business till I come. Do business. The ESV just translates it, occupy. Occupy. But quite literally, be an entrepreneur until I return. Jesus returns. He's the master. Everyone's report. Master, your denarius earned tenfold. Then you, my servant, be over what? 10 cities. Master, your denarius returned fivefold. You be over 5 cities. What is the kingdom of God like? It is the government of ruling cities. That's how all the parables function. And this is just one way to understand that the coming rule of God on earth is ruling in government form. You be over 10 cities. But especially this passage, Revelation 21, our final text for today. Revelation 21, verse 22. And I saw no temple in the city. Oh, another picture of a city. For its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it. It doesn't mean it doesn't have sun or moon. It just doesn't need it. For the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light will the nations walk, nations. And the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. Now, not those kings that were judged back there in chapter 18 and 19, but the kings of, look at the end of verse 27, look all the way at the end, all the way at the end. Those kings who are written in the Lamb's book of life. In other words, those people who are appointed to be over cities like kings. And the nations will walk, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it, and its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. They will bring into it the glory and honor of the nations, the ethnicities, these kings over cities. But nothing unclean will ever enter it, nor anyone who does what is detestable or false, but only those who are written, including those kings over those cities, who are written in the Lamb's book of life. So let me end our time like this. Isaiah 9. Oh, I told you the last text. Sorry. Unto us a child is born. Christmas is coming. Unto us a son is given. Christ crucified. And the government will be upon his shoulders. He's coming back to do this, to do this. Government is coming. What kind? One day the Prince of Peace will rule the nations and all will dwell safely and securely under lesser rulers whose names are in the book of life. Government is a way that God gets glory because that's who he is. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for these truths. Give your church wisdom and discernment as they will have to figure out Is this a time when we obey God rather than man, or not? It's going to take a lot of prayer, a lot of searching the Word of God, wisdom and discernment among brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we ask that you would help the church to be the church, to never, ever, ever let hold of the centrality of the gospel of Jesus Christ. May we feel just as urgent about it as they did in the days of the Reformation. And to that end, Lord, that's where we're going to finish Romans 13 next week, because Paul wants to call us to urgency about this. So we need your help, we need your strength, we need your courage, Lord. Get lots of glory out of the way we live our lives for you, rendering to Caesar that which belongs to Caesar, and to God the things that belong to God this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.